Call this regular workshop meeting to order, and we have a copy of a proposed agenda that's been passed out to everyone, and I would entertain a motion at this time to adopt the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Dr. Woodruff, I'm going to turn it over to you now. You have three topics on here for tonight's meeting, and we'll start with the ETJ and adjustments to that.
Thank you, Mayor, members of council. First of all, I would like to thank each of you for coming out last night to the joint session with the county commission. I think you would agree it was an excellent way of communicating. It's something that the mayor and the chairman will be commended for setting up, and we hope that we'll be able to do that at least twice, if not three times a year. This evening, as you can see, we are proposing three things: discussion of the extraterritorial jurisdiction, commonly referred to as the ETJ, and potential adjustments. Secondly, we have some very good news about the potential of a new parking lot that can be built with federal funds up at the Commons. And then Anthony's also going to give you a transportation update. Ryan's going to talk about the potential adjustments to the ETJ, but I'd like to set the tone a little bit for the meeting. Recently, the city's Board of Adjustments and Appeals met in this room to discuss a matter relative to a code enforcement issue in a residential subdivision that is not inside the city. It's within the ETJ. That matter was handled appropriately, but after the meeting was over, I did a little research to ask what was the real details. And here were the details. The gentleman in question, his neighbors had complained to the county. And the county said, well, you're in the county, but you're in the city ETJ, so you need to go to the city code enforcement to have this matter resolved. And it was resolved. And I think our staff acted very professionally. I think the Board of Adjustments and Appeals acted appropriately. But it raises the question, given the new annexation laws that we face, which basically say developed property can only be annexed into the city through a joint vote, is it really a good use of taxpayer money and city staff time to have our personnel responsible for monitoring building permits, enforcing zoning, and code enforcement in the ETJ, especially in areas that may or may not ever vote to come inside the city? My philosophy is, I have to admit, not an objective philosophy on this. If you pay city taxes, you get the extra service. If you don't pay the city taxes, you should not get the city services. Now, there are always some exceptions. What Ryan is going to show you this evening is for thought, and hopefully at the end of this meeting or a future meeting, you're going to give direction. We're certainly not proposing to eliminate the major thoroughfares of the city. If you'll recall, going out Gum Branch towards Richlands, towards Richlands several years ago, we adjusted the ETJ, and we eliminated the residential areas, but we kept the commercial corridors. And what we are proposing this evening is that you take a similar approach in other areas by saying, if it's residential and it's already developed in subdivisions, I'm not talking about, you know, acres of land that have a single family home on, but if it's a residential subdivision, the county now has zoning, they have their own code enforcement, those people do not pay taxes to the city. So the question is, why does it become our responsibility? So with that, I'm going to ask Ryan to walk you through some slides that would show you potential residential areas that are in the ETJ that you could consider eliminating and totally turning over to the county for their responsibility. Please.
Thank you, Dr. Woodruff. Mayor, Council, good evening. As Dr. Woodruff just stated, I'm going to start tonight with a little bit of history. I'm going to show you a map that basically identifies these three ETJ reductions that have occurred over the past few years. And I'm going to do that with one map, just so that you can see. The purple area on the map is the corporate city limits. The green is the ETJ area, and the blue is the annexed portion of the base. So you can see, moving from left of the screen and up and around, we dropped off from Southwest Creek towards Wilmington. We took out of the area, and then a few areas within the Southwest area.
a large area where along the New River near Oakhurst Estates was removed. Once again, a developed single-family subdivision. No real need at the time, so we removed that. All of the existing houses in Lauderdale and Raintree, Deerfield subdivision, while maintaining the corridor, as Dr. Woodruff stated, you can see the area is still in green, so we do have the planning and zoning control over that area. And then we jumped over to the Piney Green Road area, and there was one row of houses along Piney Green Road right across the street from, well, right down the street from White Oak High School, where we just had the frontage lots along Piney Green Road. We took those areas out and just stayed on the west side of Piney Green Road, and then eliminated the area where Hunter's Creek Middle School and Elementary School is, and the housing development around that area, and a little bit of area closest to Highway 24 and Piney Green Road. So council has reduced this three times over the last few years. So staff has kind of begun the process of looking at areas, and I'm going to show you some lines that, you know, obviously can be amended, and these are just rough lines, if you will, even though they may look a little bit more specific. And we've identified some additional properties in basically all of the same areas, the southwest area. There's a subdivision off of Ramsey Road that part of the subdivision's in the ETJ on one side of the street, and on the other side of the street is in the county jurisdiction, so we propose to kind of take that out so everybody on that cul-de-sac would have the same zoning laws and go to the same governing body. And then some larger pockets of existing developed land along Piney Green Road, and I've got a few close-up shots, so I'll go ahead and start there. So this is the southwest area. So maintaining the ETJ along Highway 17, the corridor, but removing the areas that are just in, you know, just to the west of Highway 17. Now, council may say, no, we want to keep this area, but we've also identified we don't believe that there's any water and sewer service that's going to be provided here in any time in the near future. So this is one area that we identified. The existing subdivision nearest Southwest Middle School is the area to the top of the screen.
What is that called?
Is that Springdale Acres?
Springdale Acres.
So that area already goes to the, there's a, I believe, a private package plant that Onwassa took over, I believe, and now it goes to the city's pump station that's a recently constructed pump station at the old strawberry farm.
Are you dissecting property lines in that area?
We would not.
It looks like you are.
It comes back to, that's a general area.
Okay.
I probably would have been better off to put just a circle over the area, but I wanted to be a little bit more finite with the line, but not quite. We would not propose to split properties in half. So the next area would be those areas along Piney Green Road. So you've got Highland Forest Subdivision, Aragona Village, I believe it's White Oak Estates, and then also the Regalwood Subdivision, and I believe that's Country Club Estates, right there nearest the shopping center. Once again, all existing developed single-family subdivision. Lots are already built upon.
Those are all served by Onwassa and as far as water and sewer?
Yes, sir. Yeah. And this is a good example of, and I don't know how to draw on this. How do you draw on this thing?
Just draw. Magic finger.
You know, we would refine the actual boundaries. You can see in that area that there are some larger parcels. But Mr. Bittner, you raised the good question. No, we would not split parcels. What we're really looking at are the platted subdivisions, and that would be the area that would come out. Now, if any of the platted lots, developed or undeveloped, are along the corridor, they would stay in.
Where's the Koenig property at? Didn't we annex that?
Koenig property is this piece of property here.
But that's in the city there.
Yes. And remember, by state law, you do not have to go from unincorporated to ETJ to annexation. You can go from unincorporated to satellite annexation or unincorporated straight to annexation. There's no middle step that requires you to be in the ETJ before you become part of the city.
And why would you keep the residential on the corridor?
only if you're, and we may not keep all of it, but the answer is so that we have control over the types of uses and the appearance of the corridor. Because it is logical that the corridor is going to become, or at least has the potential, to be your future city. For example, in this area down here, you know, while I believe this is White Oak High School, there is vacant property that's here. There are other vacant properties, you know, obviously White Oak High School. We've talked to them about annexing into the city in the past. But all you'd be doing is controlling your ability. If you're going to provide water and sewer, and if it's vacant property, and if it's on the corridors, you're simply controlling what goes on there.
I'm thinking about more back up towards, say, Country Club Road, where you've got the, like you said, the
up in this area,
right back there in the Country Club Hills or Estates, whatever.
We could certainly look at that.
I mean, I don't understand. Just, you're thinking a house is going to go from a residential to commercial just because it's on Piney Green Road?
A lot of them will.
Yes, sir.
A lot of them will. But on the other hand, you know, again, what we're talking about is how y'all feel about keeping the ETJ. And if you feel that in areas like the one I just circled should not be kept, we're looking for guidance.
What's the downside?
Mr. Bittner,
keeping or leaving?
The downside
changing,
of
eliminating parts of it.
Yeah. I think everybody has an opinion as to what the downside is. My only thought is that we already tell people if you're going to be on city water or sewer or both, you have to annex. The only downside that I can see is a development that is on a major road approaching the city that could wind up being something unattractive or inappropriate. To me, that's the only downside. Now, staff members, I'll be quite frank with you, staff members have told me that they're opposed to this, that they think that once you give it up, you're never going to get it back. My comment is, what are you giving up? You're not giving up the future city, because if you actually believe those folks are going to vote themselves into the city when they're getting city services free.
Well, don't we have an obligation to protect the property interest of our people that are in the city, that are on this adjacent property?
Yes.
But then aren't you, how to say this, impugning the other government agencies that we're talking about? I mean, is that not, saying we have to protect, implying that someone else wouldn't?
Well, I see the point you make. It's not intended to be a negative comment, because I think part of giving up these subdivisions is the reality that the county has matured, that they have zoning, that they now have code enforcement.
And water and sewer.
And they have water and sewer.
Where's the cutoff there for water on Piney Green Road?
Well, generally, Wally, you're going to have to come up here and help us out here in a second.
Where our water and sewer authority is, where we supply.
Well, and I'll say that's one of the reasons why we didn't propose with this first cut of our first attempt at a line, was because of the water and sewer district that's in that area closest to 17 and Piney Green Road. That's another reason why we didn't identify that area to come out. But
so I'll start with sewer because it's easiest. This parcel, I believe it's this one, is our Popular Branch pump station that was constructed as part of the Piney Green Road project and in cooperation with Omwasa. And we have a line essentially that comes up here. Trying to find the creek. Where's the creek?
Right here.
So,
and this is our line.
Is our line. Excuse me. So our line comes up, and it is designed to serve essentially vacant property along this corridor. And of course, we've looked at, you know, future plans of what other vacant property in this entire general area that we could direct to that line. In addition, you may recall that there's 200,000 gallons of our line that's reserved for Omwasa to serve existing developed property. For example, while 200,000 gallons wouldn't be enough, but currently this area up top is Regalwood, is served by a package plant, privately owned. if that were to fail or be turned over to Onwassa in the future, Onwassa could conceivably turn it into, through our agreement, into our line and take it to their system further down Piney Green. In addition, you have what is Aragona Village that also has a private sewer system, which is this area. You know, through agreement, part of that may could be turned into our line. So there is capacity in our line reserved for developed property that has failing septic systems. You know, another one, and I don't know which ones are, have been problems in the past, but I know that this one was discussed at one point. I believe those are actually septic systems. So Onwassa was looking ahead and saying, we may need some capacity in your line. So our agreement does allow for that. So that takes care of sewer. Water, we do not have anything along Piney Green Road. So actually, if I can ask Glenn or Alan to remove those. Thank you. So Onwassa has a 24-inch water main, and I believe it's on the northern side, that they constructed with the road widening project. And that
that's, serves, that's Onwassa's water line?
That is Onwassa's water line, and that serves, that is the backbone for everything in this area that Onwassa serves. Onwassa serves the areas that we've talked about in Aragona Village, Regalwood. They actually serve some of the existing lots down Halltown Road. They serve White Oak High School. You know, they serve that little subdivision that we talked about before. They also serve Hunters Creek and those areas.
What about that area up 17 north so, there that we were looking at as far as Plaza?
So are you talking about right at the corner?
Yes, sir.
So this area that you can see, the purple and green mix, is actually served by the city of Jacksonville for water and sewer. We extended a 12-inch water main across Piney Green Road into that property. So we serve what is North Marine Town Center with water and sewer. Now, we do have an area. Glenn, if I can ask you to erase it one more time. With the country club annexation that the city did, there's an area here. It's actually in city limits. Don't hold me to the exact line because I know that was done as part of the country club annexation. The city extended sewer into that area, but it is currently served by Onwassa water. They were Onslow County customer water customers at the time. They had septic systems. We extended sewer infrastructure into that area, annexed them, and they tied into our sewer system. But they are currently served by Onwassa water. And we actually, because the Onwassa rate is slightly higher than the city's, we actually subsidize that area because we cannot charge them a different water rate. We have to charge city limit customers the same water rate.
So is there ever going to be some type of a reciprocal agreement there where we're giving up something somewhere else that we can equalize those rates?
You want me to answer that? We've talked multiple times with Onwassa about you know, what options are in that area. We've actually studied that area, and basically, other than some line sizes and maybe hydrant spacing, they receive the same service as pretty much the rest of the city receives. But we have talked about whether we could acquire those customers, whether it be through purchase or swaps or you know, other things. One of the challenges that Onwassa's mentioned that they face is some of their bond covenants, they cannot lose customers. So that's part of the challenge that they've been looking at. So, you know, but we have talked about what options are in those areas because we do have some mixed areas that are in the county that are not, you know, in city limits that we actually serve. One that comes to mind is Green Crest Circle out off of 258. It's weird because Onwassa serves half of that subdivision, we serve the other half. Now, I'm not sure how at the time that was developed and how that happened, but we do serve, you know, a portion of that subdivision. And Rock Creek is another example. We serve Rock Creek, and we're actually responsible for the lines, maintaining the lines in Rock Creek.
That's part of a deal that everybody, a lot of people don't realize it was made to put those pumps out there, right?
That's correct.
Mayor, one of the things that we, that Mr. Carter and I have talked about, along with Wally, we would like to enter into a series of discussions with the new executive director of ONWASA and with their council to determine how we might be able to address some of these issues that you've just talked about. I also believe that that there is the possibility for us to revisit some of the previous decisions relative to wholesaling of water. As you will recall, when we were developing or annexing in the property known as Patriot Park, which was the Koenig property, we asked the county, would they wholesale? I'm sorry, we asked ONWASA if they would wholesale. The answer at that time was no. On the other hand, I believe that there are opportunities that we should continue to explore. You know, going back, you can see...
The decision by ONWASA wasn't unanimous.
That's correct. I believe the vote was 5-2. Now, you can see from what Wally has shown you, all of the undeveloped property that's through here, you know, we would want to keep that, you know, from the standpoint of being able to regulate it. On the other hand, if they're going to be served by water and sewer, because we do have a contract with ONWASA, ONWASA can't serve vacant properties. So, you know, one approach is to simply say, well, all of this stuff down here, we're going to take it all out. Because if they ever want sewer, we're going to be able to control it. I think the general question tonight, though, is are you comfortable with us getting into detailed discussions, detailed analytics with the staff to begin to reduce the ETJ based upon the discussion, the justification we're giving you?
I don't know whether this has an impact or not, but when the legislature amended the annexation laws, cut them back, didn't they also do something with the ETJ?
No, sir, they were going to. But that part did not, at one point there was a bill that would eliminate the ETJ completely.
Okay.
Everybody's.
They did remove the, Boone no longer has an ETJ. Yeah. They took it away from Boone.
Okay.
That was specific. That was a local.
Can I add one thing?
Go on.
I'm sorry. I just want to make sure I gave you all the information. I did leave out one piece. The city of Jacksonville, to serve Patriot Park, does have a water line that stops. As you remember, Mr. Koenig owned all of this property, even though he only annexed that portion. It stops right here to serve Mr. Koenig and actually comes up like this and ties into the North Moraine Town Center system that we talked about.
Is that undeveloped through there?
Yes, part of this is underdeveloped.
Mm-hmm. So we're anticipating future development. That's who's going to pay for this?
Yeah, and that system is to serve Patriot Park. And there's actually, as part of our fee schedule, there's a special area assessment that they would pay facility charges to recover some of that cost when it develops.
Did we sell on loss of that part of the sewer that we put in Piney Green?
I'm sure you can.
Did we do what? Buy it?
I mean, that section there that we keep talking about there, that, I mean, that is like our stuff. If we
want yours? Yes, sir.
And the important thing to remember, our bonds have nothing, you know, let me start that again. ONWASA says that there are certain restrictions on them because of bond covenants. We do not have that restriction because the funds that we have paid for the water and sewer improvements down that way, those were not bonded improvements. I think the question that you have is, you know, once again, our philosophy was that the city is going to grow out 17 towards New Bern. A little bit of growth out 17 back towards Wilmington.
But going up 258, you know, I don't see the city really growing that way. Going out 24 past Piney Green, you know, don't know the city's going to grow that way. So what we've tried to do from a water and sewer planning standpoint is look at the capital projects, which you'll see Deanna has already finished the CIP. I believe Carmen sent that to you on Monday, yesterday. But you'll see that most of our efforts are out in this zone to serve undeveloped property.
I understand why you're bringing it forward, but I do have some concerns about rushing into removal of the ETJ. I think that, I mean, I agree with you can't get back what you give away. Piney Green is going to be a major thoroughfare, and retaining some of that control, I think, helps the community and doesn't hurt it, because it will be a major corridor once it's fully completed. And we may look at tweaking. I'm not opposed to tweaking if it needs to be, but I think your commercial corridors, and you may even explore working with the county and let them do the inspections, you know, give them the inspections so we, or, you know, see if they would take the inspections, and then we can do the other portion of the zoning portion if it's that much of a, you know, a deal for us. But again, you never know what tomorrow brings, and I understand, you know, what the thought process is, but I would take it slow.
That section on Piney Green that we Ron Lawson built for us, that's a dry line now, right? Or?
No, sir, we do have flow in that line.
From where?
Highland Shores goes
from the shopping
to that
center?
Line, mm-hmm. Yes, sir. Okay. The Food Lion, the Bojangles. Another.
And we're paying for a portion of the charge to the base.
That's
for
correct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's based as on well flow, right?
Availability. And an availability.
And availability mm-hmm. charge.
That's yeah. correct. Yeah. Yes, sir. Yeah. Well, spread by meter. We have a meter, and they send us a bill every month, and we pay the bill.
So that'll increase. We get more flow in that line?
Yes, sir. The bill would actually increase, but if I remember correctly, and I'd have to go back and study the agreement, Mr. Carter, I don't know if you can help me, but if I recall, the more flow that we put into that line, there's actually a portion that decreases some, and I don't remember what that was.
But also remember, flow equals revenue.
Pardon?
Flow equals revenue. You know, right now, we are paying a substantial annual fee. If you have flow, you have revenue coming in. You know, obviously one day when Patriot Park is developed, we've already bought that capacity, developed that capacity, but we don't have any homes that are out there.
We're paying on a basis of
the
capacity we
that's correct.
Paid for, yeah. And they built, even yeah. though we're not using it.
And I heard one time that the actual rate that we pay is probably prohibitive to even the revenue side there, that it's, I think Onwasa maybe needs to go back one day to the base and analyze that rate that they're charging, because what I learned or was told was that when they were asked, what's your rate, they just called around to municipalities.
That's correct. Comparables.
Comparables.
But it's not comparable because the municipality are providing all the infrastructure to get it to them. So it's kind of like going to say, buy a car. And you get pieces. You got to put the car together. So our rate is not, in my opinion, what it should be.
You're saying it's too low or too high?
It's too high because you're being charged for a complete product when all you're getting is the processing at the end of the line. You're not paying everything down the line that everybody else is charging.
That may take legislative action.
Mr. Thomas is correct that the rate that we are charged is not the treatment rate.
No.
It is the full base system rate.
Right.
And so even though the base is not responsible for, or that we're not responsible for any repairs on the base in the collection system,
yeah, no INI,
we are paying per gallon
right.
or per unit of charge the same rate as the base would be paying. So think of it this way. The city of Jacksonville, when you look at your water and sewer bill,
it's, let's say, the sewer bill. It's a combination of the treatment plant and the collection system. What we need to renegotiate with the base is all we're paying is the treatment system, not the collection system.
Well, we'd have to renegotiate with on Watson. On Watson, we'd have to renegotiate with the base.
Yeah, they have to. It's their deal.
But that's on our list of things to discuss with Mr. Hudson as he begins his tour there.
Well, I, for one, I don't see a problem at looking at some of these areas in the ETJ, and I'm sure there are some that can be easily identified as ones that have no future use for the city whatsoever. But I think we need to kind of tread carefully, you know, to make sure that we do protect the commercial corridors and also protect property rights of our citizens. I mean, that should be our, you know, a priority for us to make sure we protect them, because you don't want, you know, an area to be in the city and right across the street, you know, somebody comes in there and puts a trailer park in or whatever.
Well, that's what I was telling the mayor earlier. Although parts of Piney Green are not ours, when that's completed and done, people are going to think it's ours, and as many do already, because they call us on numerous. Now, we have more police cars on Piney Green probably than some of our other corridors. So if that means anything, I don't mean that in a bad way, but we're there. You know, that people perceive that as the city. So we need to be cognizant of that. And
you know, I remember a long time ago that the discussion came up about code enforcement on the ETJ, and it was asked, did we want to go looking? And we said no. I mean, so we're just basically on a response mode now.
Right.
I mean, we just
respond
to complaints.
I will tell you again, the comments that we got back, you know, on that particular case, which brought my attention to this, is I don't pay taxes. Why are you in my, you know, in my neighborhood? And the way I look at it is this: if the county has the same services we do, and you're dealing with citizens who most likely are not ever going to vote themselves taxes, if you can get it free in life, why do you sign up to pay for it?
But that's always been the argument, even when we had the rights to annex. People have said that same comment ever since I can remember. You know, why are you guys telling me what to do? I'm in the, you know, outside.
Well, it's one thing.
Well, you're in our ETJ. Well,
it's
so
one thing
what?
If you can go out and make them annex in. I mean,
but now we're there.
These people in this area right here,
no chance. No chance of annexation.
Yeah.
And it's not going to really impact any future growth of the city. So those are the ones I'm talking about there, where, you know, those are the ones that you can proceed on without any, or tweak, as Mayor Pro Tem Lazar put it, without any problem on, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, I'm not opposed to reducing the ETJ.
Tweaking.
We're just not going to.
Let's do the detailed analysis and see what we have.
And we'll take it slow. We'll take it area by area.
But that whole Piney Green thing, there needs to be some kind of resolution there as far as how that's going to be divided and conquered or what have you, you know, in the future.
Yeah, we need to work with all of us to see what's involved in there. Rate setting for that treatment. It may take legislative action, but I think we need to research it.
Well, again, we have had several good preliminary discussions with the new executive director, Mr. Hudson. We are going to continue. We're going to look at everything again, from wholesaling to is it possible for us to trade service customers. We hope everything will be on the table, and obviously y'all will be active in making those decisions. Anything else on this? I believe you have given us direction that proceed cautiously and look only at the residential areas.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Council.
Anthony?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Please.
I understand he has a new title. It's Mr. Brevity or Hope to Aspire to.
I'm on that path in life, Mr. Bittner, but I'm not quite there. So, a couple points, Dr. Woodruff, Mayor, if you don't mind, on the Piney Green issue before we move on to the park and ride.
No, let's just stay with the park and ride. That's the way you stay better.
We get the phone calls about the traffic signals, so we are there. We can agree on one point. How about that? Good evening, Mayor and Council. Thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight. We've recently achieved a pretty significant milestone in this project, so we wanted to take the opportunity to update you on where we are, where we're headed, and of course, remind you of, in fact, you know, what we're trying to accomplish with this project in general. The Park and Ride facility, if I remember correctly, has been on our capital improvement program for 6, 7 years?
Eight.
So it's been a long time coming. First of all, let's talk about what a park and ride lot is. And this is my definition. It doesn't come from any educated source by any stretch of the imagination. But it's a public... I did say that correctly.
Boy, you put yourself down, didn't you?
I did. It is a public parking, and I went to App State, by the way, so it is a public parking facility that primarily connects motorists with public transportation. Okay, that's the fundamental concept of park and ride. And in our particular case, it would be Jacksonville Transit, Amtrak, and Greyhound. So those are the three primary transit services that serve our area. And if you've noticed with the recent activity over here with Greyhound, we do a lot of business out of Jacksonville. There's no question about that. But really, in my opinion, for it to be an appropriate use of public resources, the facility should serve multiple purposes, not just transit. For instance, in a lot of cases, you'll locate a park and ride facility next to a library or next to a conference center or you know, other public facilities that can benefit from having the supplemental parking when it's all not being used by the transit system itself. And they come in a variety of forms. Those of us who are familiar with the DC area, you know, this is on the way extreme side of park and ride, but this is where they're at right now because of their commuter patterns. Park and ride facility with a 4-story deck, a large transfer facility. But again, it's the same concept of what we're trying to accomplish with our facility, just at a much smaller scale. On the other end of the spectrum, you could simply reserve some areas in an existing parking lot. This is a facility that I worked on in Wilmington when I was there. It was as simple as going to the manager of Lowe's Improvement and saying, hey, we've got a concept. We want to use some of your underutilized parking spaces for this purpose. They said yes, but gave no promises for the long term. Of course, that is the downside of this type of approach. But as of today, it's still operating. However, they do not have the flexibility that we're looking for in a park and ride facility at the Commons that they have in this kind of environment, using it for a variety of different purposes. This is strictly for the UNCW shuttle service. And just as a point of reference, this is the Lowe's Home Improvement in Monkey Junction. So they're really capturing a lot of the students that come from the Carolina Beach area. This is an image of what our facility is hopefully going to look like once it's completed. It's certainly not as large and complex as the facility in DC, and it's not as simplified as the one in Wilmington, but you've got capacity for probably a couple hundred vehicles there. You've got a bus circulation area, shelter where people can wait when the weather is bad, some landscaping, of course, to make it nice. But again, the idea is that the facility and its location could be used for multiple purposes. So if, in fact, these spaces are not 100% occupied by transit users, they could be occupied by other customers of our facilities at the Commons. So again, it serves multiple purposes. I've already talked about that, but a perfect example of that is we recently advertised the park and ride service for the city's Winterfest down at Riverwalk Park. And we advertised it as saying you can get on at the Commons because there were some activities over at the Commons with that event. Well, it may not have been connected to Winterfest, but there were some activities over there. So you could get on at the Commons, you could go downtown, and you could get your ride back for free. And in fact, we served more people on that shuttle route than we did with the downtown circulator that we normally run for that event that takes people from the City Hall parking lot and other areas in the downtown to go to Winterfest. So that was pretty amazing. I didn't personally even expect that. So it shows that for at least city events, there is a demand for that park and ride. The Commons is a central location in its geography and also with the roadway network that surrounds it. As you know, we're interested in extending Jacksonville Parkway, which gives this great access to the greater arterial roadway network. And it's a good location for transit because we currently serve that area. Key to this is that it's city-owned property already. So our intent with this project, just like the multimodal center, is to use the value of the land that we already own to leverage the federal money needed to design it and to construct it. Okay, I'm not sure if we're going to get there with the multimodal center because of the cost of that building, but I think that goal is well within reach with the park and ride facility. And we'll go through the finances here in just a second. One technical benefit of doing this project at the Commons is now we have the ability to update all of our stormwater permits for that facility, which really haven't been revisited in quite some time, but in the process, we can have transit pay for it. So that is a very tangible benefit to us as a city. We evaluated 62 locations, and this one was found to be the best.
Of course, the one real advantage that you left off is whose house is it close to?
Well, we know whose house it's closest to.
I thought it was the view.
The view of Lake Bittner.
Right. Yeah, their namesake water feature, right? So this is the location that we're proposing for the park and ride. And interestingly enough, when the Commons was, well, I'm not going to say that. The latest master plan that we have for the Commons showed this as an area where we would install some parking. Now, at the time, transit didn't exist, okay, and there was no thought of that being a park and ride facility, but it does show how, you know, we can have the mutual benefit of constructing something that we already said that we wanted with funding that's available from another revenue source. You know the context out there, so I won't explain it, but it's close to the softball fields, it's close to the multi-purpose complex, so on and so forth. And you can also see, because these are brand new aerials, it's right next to or within close proximity to the new amphitheater.
Yeah. So people could park here and walk over.
It's a pretty brown lake. Yeah. Pretty.
This is the concept plan that we've come up with. And by no means is this what we're actually going to put on the ground. This was just a bubble concept that we drew to get our FTA approvals to be able to begin programming funding for the project. But essentially, this is the way we would like it to operate, and the fact that we would have connectivity from Commons Drive towards the south, all the way up to the existing access drive for the multi-purpose complex and the senior center. And where the roadway gets wide there, next to those two blue ovals or triangles, that's where we would have bus pullouts so that the buses could queue on the road. And in the blue areas, we would have shelters, you know, where they could wait to access the bus. But as we had the turnouts there, the roadway could continue to operate while the buses were there waiting. Some other benefits, and because we worked hand in hand with recreation and parks, some other benefits is the fact that we would like to, or that we're planning to, enhance the emergency access to the softball fields with this project. So the green, heavy, bold line there that you see is an area that we would like to reinforce as part of this project so that ambulances and other rescue vehicles can have direct access to those softball fields. Currently, they have to go through the existing parking lot that's right next to the multi-purpose building, and it's kind of a roundabout way to get to the softball fields, but this, again, would provide them a very direct route. We do have a well site out there on the property, and of course, we've worked with public services to design around that. But with the project, we would also get rid of the existing driveway on Commons Drive for that facility and bring it in off of the drive aisle that we would construct. So looking at the funding strategy, again, we want to use the value of the land as the in-kind match to leverage the federal funds. And we're in the process right now of having Suzanne Nelson do an appraisal for the property. We don't know exactly what that's going to come out like, but it's almost certain to be a lot more than $187,500. So the money that I'm showing there is just what we would need to leverage the FTA funds that we feel would be a reasonable budget for the project. Now, if in fact, you know, we design the project and the budget goes up, say it's $800,000 or $850,000 or whatever it might be, you know, there's still probably some room left in the value of the property that we have to be able to leverage that FTA money without having to put any cash in. When it's all said and done, operations and maintenance is going to be a concern. And because it's primarily a transit facility, we will be able to pay for operations and maintenance with the transit budget. Now, of course, that comes with a general fund obligation, but it's roughly about 25% of the total cost.
What would they be, operation and management?
Well, say for instance, the street lighting, or, you know, from time to time we have to replace glass in the bus shelters, or, you know, broken sidewalks, streets. Right, there's kinds of, you know, fringe costs that pop up. Now, I will say, you know, we've talked about how it's going to have multiple purposes. We've been very upfront with the FTA about this from the very beginning, okay? And they see the benefit in having these facilities serve multiple purposes within the community. So we're going into this open and honest about what we intend to do with this facility once it's complete, and they support it. The timeline, we do have FTA approval to begin allocating funds for design and construction. The design we hope to have complete in the fall of 17, and Deanna's shaking her head, so that must be the right answer. With that, I think it's probably a lofty goal to begin construction before the end of this year, but that's what we're going to shoot for. It's very likely to be the beginning of next. And when it's all said and done, we hope to have it wrapped up by the end of that fiscal year.
Anybody have any objections with us moving forward?
We really appreciate your support and feel that this will be a great addition to the Commons once it's done.
Now, before we take our break and come back for the transportation, Anthony, would you please give them a quick update on traffic issues on Piney Green?
The signals are ours, so we're getting all of the calls. That's the long and the short of it.
And by the signals, you're talking about the ones mm-hmm. at both ends and in the middle?
Along the entire corridor.
So you're getting a bunch of calls?
In some locations, namely at the high school, White Oak High School, and we're working with DOT to redesign the signal plan for that intersection so that it's a lot safer and it's a lot more efficient for the traveling public. One of the real conflicts out there is just the volume of pedestrians that they have crossing the road every day. And so we know that motorists aren't very patient, right? And so it's causing a lot of conflict. And hopefully DOT, I can't remember the timeline, but hopefully DOT will have those revised plans done within the next couple of weeks. And we're going to do what's called a lead pedestrian interval, where, you know, when the side street starts to go, the pedestrian gets 10 to 15 seconds of lead time so that they can get out into the road and be visible, you know, make it almost all the way across before the side street comes up and turns green for the cars. That's where we're getting all of our complaints from right now.
You've got a more complex there than you do at Jacksonville High School with its.
No question.
No question.
It's all one point of ingress and egress, which we try to discourage with schools and commercial development. So.
There's a rumor that Piney Green might be completed by this year.
That's a lot. That's a
lot. Well, we will just call that a rumor, Mr. Bittner.
That's a lot.
Well, and what I told Michaela the other day when we were doing the interview for her article is that the goal is to have it done this spring. okay? And really, the contractor is working on punch list items, at least that's what I'm being told. And the biggest holdup is warmer weather for the last layer of asphalt. DOT has a certain moratorium that they set each year. I can't remember, it's November to April or something like that, where they won't allow contractors to put down new asphalt because of the weather conditions. So once that's done, hopefully we can finish Piney Green Road.
One other comment on Piney Green. The project due to funding does not have any sidewalks in it at all, except the portion that's inside the city. And the city funded those sidewalks.
We did get a very small amount of money, but it was generous at the time, no question, from Mrs. Fountain. Correct. To put some sidewalks out there. I can't remember the name of the subdivision. But it was in support of the cross-country trail that the high school uses to train. So she was able to get us some sidewalk money for that. But that is sidewalk in the unincorporated area of the county, which is a first for Onslow County that I'm aware of.
If you'd like to take a few minute break, we'll come back and talk about transportation update.
Oh, thank you.
Control of
the station. Oh, I do.
I believe you do.
Everybody's looking at me.
Transportation update, Anthony.
Thank you, Dr. Woodruff. Mayor and Council, we've spent a lot of time over the past 2 or 3 years talking about the new DOT prioritization process, and we're going to spend just a few minutes of your time giving you an update on where we are with the fourth iteration of that. Mr. Lazara and Mr. Warden are very aware of this. But we did touch upon the draft tip and some of the results at one of your last meetings. I think it was 2 or 3 meetings ago. There was a memo circulated and we had a brief conversation. But what we'd like to do tonight is to go through the specifics on some projects that we've been able to retain on the TIP, some new projects that we've been able to fund, and unfortunately some projects that have fallen off the tip. So you see on the right-hand side the cyclical evolution of prioritization. Right now we're in the stage where DOT is asking us to consider the tip that they've developed and to consider adopting it. Of course, that will occur through the MPO and not the City Council. Some of the retained projects, and this is the good news, these are projects that were scheduled in the out years of the TIP, meaning years 6 through 10, okay, of the program, that were subject to reprioritization, but they survived the cut, okay? Probably most significant project there is the Jacksonville Parkway extension. That was a project that was very high on our priority list, and fortunately it did remain. And in fact, DOT is looking at ways to expedite that project even further, but we'll talk about that here in a few minutes. Western Extension, all of the projects to widen the intersections that we've talked about, Gateway South, Gateway North, Henderson, Gum Branch Road, all of those survived. The Western Median, that's on the older section of Western between Marine Boulevard and Lejeune Boulevard, that is going to move forward, as well as the Culvert Project that we've talked about, I can't tell you how many times. Commerce Drive Extension, that's a new roadway that's going to be constructed over near Piney Green, and the two interchange projects that were funded, one at the air station main gate, and then the other one at the end of the bypass heading towards Richlands. So all of those are safe. They have been retained for funding. We'll continue to move forward. Two new projects that were able to be placed on the tip, excuse me, one is between Henderson and Onslow Drive on Marine Boulevard. Now, the oval there really reflects how enigmatic this project is right now. We don't know exactly what the improvements are going to be, but we know that there are improvements to be made. There's no question that of the two, the intersection of Marine and Henderson is probably the most problematic, and we're going to end up doing some widening in that area. But we'd also like to look at the ways that we can more effectively manage the traffic in between the two. So that is a funded project. It's moving forward, and we'll give you more details as those come about. One of the biggest criticisms of the Jacksonville Parkway when it opened was the fact that people coming from downtown could not get on it. Okay? So if you want to, if you're coming from downtown and you want to head towards the north, you know, Western Boulevard area, you have to come to this traffic signal here that's shown on the screen. You have to make a left, you have to go down to Western, you have to make another left. And through the project, we also took out the left over at Moose Haven, which made people excited as well. But this project is going to modify the interchange so that we would have a ramp of some sort that would allow folks to go from the downtown area on Marine Boulevard and get directly on the Jacksonville Parkway. Unfortunately, there were some very key projects that fell off the tip. And I think from Mr. Lazar's facial expression there, we're very concerned about the future of those projects. Gum Branch Road initially, and you probably heard in the news about the public meeting that was held a few weeks ago, that was for the first project to widen Gum Branch, where we were going to add some turn lanes and some paved shoulders, etc. The one that fell off of the TIP was the ultimate project. That was to take the roadway from two lanes to four lane divided. And that's something that I know the TAC members were very interested in pursuing, but it didn't score well in the last round of prioritization. Same thing with Henderson Drive widening. That's the section between Gum Branch and Western Boulevard. While we still have money to widen the intersection itself at Western, the widening of the roadway segment itself is no longer funded. And then the extension of Henderson, did I say Western before? May have. Anyways, the extension of Henderson from the Longhorn area back into the Commons was initially funded as well, but that project is also no longer funded. Probably one of the biggest impact projects for our entire region was the NC-111 extension. That was the project to connect 258 and Gum Branch Road at Highway 111 and Ramsey Road, okay? And that project was funded last time. We didn't think that it was funded adequately, but it had funding attached to it. Unfortunately, that's no longer the case. So that's another project that we're gonna have to continue to advocate for. And then the final one there was a widening of 111. It wasn't to take it to a four-lane divided roadway, but it was to add paved shoulders and turn lanes where it made sense. So there, we did receive some new projects from the new TIP, but unfortunately, in the process, we did lose some pretty significant ones. Right now, we're working with the DOT to see if we can salvage a couple of these. The first is Henderson Drive widening. That project really needs to go. If I have my druthers on any of these, that one really needs to go because it makes the most sense right now. The right-of-way is already there, the traffic is already there, etc. We already have 25% designs. So I'm relatively confident that we'll be able to convince the DOT to bring that one back. The extension of Henderson Drive is more than likely going to be connected to the Jacksonville Parkway extension project when it's constructed. So that's another way that we may not add it onto the TIP, but we may be able to get it anyways as part of another project.
Why were the projects?
Well, funding was a lot of it.
I thought you said some of them had funding in place already.
They did. But the funding in the out years, meaning years 6 through 10, is not secure. Only the funding between in years 1 through 5 is secure and guaranteed to move forward. So what really happened with the process is that Wilmington had some really competitive projects this time. And the two projects that they were able to fund absorbed about $160 million worth of the funding. So that displaced every single one of the ones that you see here.
How often is this cycle?
It's every 2 years. If you ask me, it's too frequently. Because, you know, you really kind of lose the strategy and the system, and this is just me talking again, you kind of lose the strategy and the system if you continuously change your mind as to what you're doing. But that's for another discussion. Project acceleration. This is one of the bright spots in the process, though. Secretary Tata, when he was in office, he was very interested in decentralizing the project development process. That means design, environmental assessment, everything leading up to the point where you're letting the project for construction, okay? So a number of the projects have been decentralized down to the district or the division office in Castle Hayne, and that has really accelerated the pace on development. It's accelerated the pace to the point where all of the projects that are currently identified on the draft tip, their goal is to have them designed, permitted, and ready for construction by 2021. So the entire 10-year inventory of those projects they hope to have done, or their goal is to have them done and ready to go within the next 5 years. Of course, with the goal of accelerating construction. One of those projects, as I mentioned before, is Jacksonville Parkway. And they're looking at innovative strategies for being able to deliver these projects in an accelerated fashion. What they're looking for with Jacksonville Parkway is a design build. So essentially, and this is not common to North Carolina at all, and in fact, I think the enabling legislation is very recent that actually allows DOT to do this, but they'll send this concept out for bid by a company, okay? And the company will submit their proposal as to how they're going to do the final planning, the design, the permitting, all the way through to construction, and then at the end of construction, DOT will take over the product. But that's a way to really kind of compress that whole project delivery timeline is by handing it over to a company that has the capacity to do this. Most foreign countries do this all the time. And in fact, other states throughout the nation do it as well. Next steps, the draft STIP was released in January. And of course, I provided a copy of that to the council. If you misplaced that or if you need it again, I'm happy to email that out or to give you a printed copy. In the meantime, what we're going to do is we're going to have a public involvement period where we'll invite the public to give us feedback on the draft TIP, but also in turn, we're very likely to ask the city council to weigh in on some of these changes to the TIP so that we can give that feedback to DOT. And we're also going to ask the MPO Transportation Advisory Committee to do the same thing. And it's very likely that we would ask the County Commission to do that as well. So, you know, these are heavy hitting issues for our community, particularly that 111 extension. And so really want to take advantage of that public involvement period. The goal is to adopt the TIP in June-ish, I should say. Usually it bleeds into July and August, but we're already gearing up for the P5.0 process. We're going to submit projects within the next 2 weeks, and we'll be back in the cycle again. We're also going to continue to support the development of all the projects that we have that are secured and ready to move forward. So any questions about the new TIP or projects we gained, lost, et cetera, before I move on to the next topic?
Just make a comment. There's the process is still continuing to be tweaked. This is, you know, the purpose of this whole process was to take the decision-making out of Raleigh's hands and pretty much try to make it statewide, decentralize the decision making. Who knows better what streets or roads are needed for our area than we do, and the MPOs and the rural POs, RPOs, and so too many times there was too much politics involved in the decision making. This is designed to be more data driven, safety, traffic counts, and funding, obviously, and et cetera. Well, what's happened is sometimes this process works well and sometimes it doesn't work well. One of the things that that we complained about this time. You saw we lost some projects from that we had originally out there from years 6 to 10. Well, you know, some of them were already had a little bit of design in them, and so here we've spent some money on design, or actually DOT has spent some money on design, and they fall off, and that's not what was intended. It's one of those unintended consequences of I think every 2 years. I don't know if we need to go to a 3 year or whatever. And certainly once you've entered into design and start spending money on design, it makes no sense to pull it off. It makes more sense to continue to keep that funded so that you eventually get to build something that you've decided that your community needs. So as it so happens, Peggy Holland on Anthony's staff is part of that working group that reports back to the state TIP. They have a working group that makes recommendations. They're the guys that see the how things are implemented and what needs to be tweaked and what needs to be changed. And so we've made some changes, but we still have some more, I think, to go on. So long-winded, but just say that it's really been a blessing to us. I think we've Oslo County has actually gained, I think, because of this process. Whereas in the past, maybe if we had some weak representation at both in the state legislature and at DOT, we wouldn't get projects. But now it's become a little more data-driven, a little more, I think, a little more transparent, I think,
Certainly. There's no question about that. Definitely more transparent, definitely more data-driven. But as you mentioned, there is room for improvement. Yeah. And as we go through these evolutions, we're making changes. Some of those changes have unintended consequences, like good projects falling off. But we hope to smooth that out as we go into P5 and P6.
And I see where the legislature is wanting to do some tweaks also. You know, one of the things that we do is we assign points to various projects. We do, the state does, the division level does, and the division engineer on behalf of the division level. And so behalf of the working group, I think is where this kind of came about, said, hey, we'd like to take a little bit of the points away from the division engineer and give them back to the MPOs and the RPOs. So that's so the local, again, giving more local input and decentralizing that. So I think that's going to be a positive if it goes through.
Certainly. And the logic behind that change is that you could say that DOT's vote was being double counted because the division engineer was able to weigh in with points, and then as part of the TAC, the DOT board member was able to weigh in on points. So the thought is maybe decline it a little bit over here, increase it over here to kind of balance the table a little bit. But it's yet to be seen where exactly that legislation is going.
But one of the other changes that we're hoping to do is to change it from a 5-year funding to a 7-year funding, guaranteed.
That would be good.
You cannot take a major road project and get it designed, the right-of-way purchased, everything finished in the 5 years that you have today. So we have talked to Representative Cleveland, Representative Shepherd, and Senator Brown about supporting a change that would make that a guaranteed 7-year window, not a 5-year window.
And from a selfish standpoint, if that were the case today, all of those projects would remain on the TIP. So change gears a little bit, some good news from the transit perspective. Next Monday, we intend to roll out the Orange Route. And as you remember, we've been talking about this for probably 2 or 3 years now. There have been various hurdles to overcome in the process, driver shortages, shortages of vehicles, etc. But the intent of the Orange Route is to provide service on a very frequent basis, actually, from the Yop Road area through Georgetown, through downtown, Hargett Street, over to the mall and back. So this is the number one request that we've had from our passengers for the longest time. And we're finally at the point where this service is going on the road Monday. we're having a soft rollout on Saturday, just so that we can iron out some of the bugs before, you know, we make a big splash on Monday. But this is going to be a big addition for us with transit. Another thing that you're going to notice with the signs that we're putting out there, we're going to start hopefully tomorrow going through the rest of the week. We're switching from a galvanized U-channel post to a powder-coated black post. So hopefully that'll give the transit stops a little bit of a better eye appeal. The cost really is marginal for the powder-coated post versus the U-channel, but it's those small details that really count in a lot of cases.
Hopefully that'll take it. I know there's probably an underserved population there, and there's a good possibility of a lack of transportation, personal transportation in those communities. So.
Certainly. From the residential standpoint, no question, but then also the number one rule in transit, and I may have said this before, you always serve Walmart. You always serve Walmart. And there's a big Walmart out there that we haven't been serving for the longest time. So, two check marks.
Hopefully we'll help sales tax.
Yet to be seen. From a traffic signal standpoint, Piney Green Road remains a challenge. We are in the process of taking over those traffic signals, but the orange cones out there are really our biggest hurdle. And we can't optimize the progression of those corridors until we have all the lanes available to us.
I have to ask about the coming back from the county last night. Where was all those orange cones on our travel back by the front of the public safety?
It was Ridge Road. They had some lanes blocked off, and this is where I saw them on the way out. They had some lanes blocked off on 258 because they're preparing for the Ridge Road realignment project.
This was in the city limits. I didn't remember it well enough. But,
is that where they're doing the power line replacements?
Yes.
Very likely.
Yeah.
Very likely.
I saw them looked like they were moving a sign back too. Yes. To get ready for the return of lane.
So Piney Green Road remains a challenge, and of course, we won't be able to fully resolve that until the road is complete. As you probably remember, the City Council endorsed a modification to our MOU with Camp Lejeune probably 3-4 months ago to expand our pilot program of integrating traffic signals into ITS, and that has been a huge success. I think the feedback at the meeting that we had with the general and all the stakeholders was very positive. In fact, that's one of the areas that we're probably going to look at for expanding our partnership with the base. But again, they really appreciate it, and it's going well. Blue Toad, the TAC authorized us to purchase a system. Ron calls it the cousin to our Blue Frog system, but this is Blue Toad. It's a system that allows us to collect data on a very continuous basis of what the travel patterns are. Where is there congestion? Where is the traffic moving freely? And so the benefit of that is, of course, it gives us really good data for the ITS system, but we're also going to be able to publish all of this information for public consumption. It's got a really nice map with the greens and the yellows and the reds and all that you see on Google Maps. It's also got a mobile application, so you can see it on your phone. But once we get that program set up, we'll be sure to send you more information on it. And I know I've mentioned this before, but traffic on Western Extension just continues to be a problem. There are a lot of vehicles out there, and we don't have enough asphalt. So hopefully as we move forward into this P5 process, the MPO will emphasize the need to widen Western Extension to a 6-lane divided facility. I believe I mentioned that the traffic counts are around 60,000 vehicles per day in near Gateway North. That's in fact where we're at. I mean, those are larger traffic counts than on the bypass most days, okay? And the bypass is a freeway type of road. This was really emphasized during the Valentine's Day. It wasn't a holiday, but during Valentine's Day, we had a really interesting phenomenon happen where the inbound traffic during the peak hour in the afternoon was higher than the outbound traffic. So the travel patterns completely flipped on us, okay? And we didn't know it until it was happening. But because of all that traffic, it was just gridlock out there. Thankfully enough, you know, we have Rob who sits in the center and stares at all of those monitors. He was able, he manually controlled every single one of those traffic signals until the congestion broke. But the point is that we need more lanes out there. There's absolutely no question about it.
You know, and it grew quickly, I would say in the last year, it just exploded.
Well, Michaela's going to quote me on these numbers, and they'll probably be wrong, but between 2012 and 2014, I believe there was a 15% increase in traffic volumes on Western, on that section of Western. Now, a 3% increase in traffic is a huge growth, okay? So you're talking about 15% over 2 years. I would say that we've at least matched that between 14 and 16. That just gives you some good perspective on the amount of pressure that we're dealing with out there right now. We're doing the best that we can, but again, we need more asphalt out there. We're paying attention to it every day and optimizing.
It's changed my patterns going to work. I no longer go that way to work.
On Western, on the extension?
Yeah, I used to come up Henderson Drive extension and go through Commons. I go home that way only because it's worse to me trying to go down 17, and because I hate that when you cross over Western on 17 and you got to make that merge. Two lanes trying to go to, you know, it's just awkward. It's very awkward at that intersection getting if you want to go 17 south.
And that's actually something we're going to fix with one of our widening projects. Yeah. So we're going to correct the geometry there.
It's just odd.
And the phenomena that I told you about on Valentine's Day, I've never seen that anywhere else. I've never heard of that anywhere else, where the inbound traffic on that particular day is heavier than the outbound. So I think that's very unique to our community.
Other questions on transportation?
I think we probably be a good time to publicly thank Ms. Fountain.
Yes.
For her work in our community and Division III in general. She was a very good representative and a friend to our board, and she did all she could do to help us. And, you know, we want to wish her well and to thank her for all of her support. She will be missed. As most of you know, we lost a board member that went to Wilmington this time. But we will continue to...
Wilmington got two out of
they
the
got
deal.
Two. Because they have a port. They have a port, and now they have a... But, you know, that, again, I think you hit it on the head earlier when you talked about, you know, the political side of it. We got to continue to work, and we got to continue to develop relationships and work the program. But, again, I just wanted to thank Ms. Fountain for all her work and dedication on our behalf.
Mayor, that concludes the items we had on the workshop. Are there other items you'd like to ask us about or updates that you'd like? We have a few minutes.
Yes. Good workshop.
Just since Zing Zoom is no longer interested in Fire Station 2, what are we thinking about Fire Station 2?
Well, the Recreation Department would like to expand some of its athletic programs, physical fitness type programs, not athletic programs. We find that the senior center is very heavily booked with various types of, what are those things that you do over there, Mr. Thomas?
It's close to dancing, but it's not really. Okay. There's a great program. We've got a new personal trainer. It's been with us, I can't remember how long, but Nikki, I'm not sure her last name, and JoJo. They have classes Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. And I've been going since before I went to the senior center luncheon before Christmas. And I met her and asked her about the programs. And so she told me, she said, well, if you get a chance on Tuesday, 8 o'clock, you know, stop by. And I was thinking, well, that's great, personal trainer. Well, I walked in as a whole class. But I did join. And it was just a myriad of people. It was a lot of people from church that I knew and some other people I knew from the community, and they're able to adapt it to any level of fitness, so it's become very popular. I mean, it's maxing out. We have to do reservations for the next class. I mean, she does such a great job. JoJo's been doing it a long time, so there's a lot of, you know, we need to do something. It was really disappointing because I thought we might actually, I mean, it's a pay program. It's $1.25 a class. You know? So when we had 20, I said, well, we might make some money here. You know, we've got to pay that one person. Well, anyway, I've come home raving about it so much that, heck, my wife quit her job so she can come do the class with us.
It's, you made it.
Yeah, that's really, it's really a fantastic program, and it's enjoyable. Like I said, my preacher's mother there, and we've got just a every level. She can adapt, everything's modified, so, and we all need more exercise, or most of us do, so it's, I'm really excited about it, and of course when it starts, summertime gets here, I won't have time, but it's, we need to expand that, and it'd be a great, great thing, because we're restricted, and we need to
fire station, old Fire Station 2 has asbestos in it. Regardless of what we do with the building, that asbestos needs to come out. We've already had the report to identify the asbestos products. Between now and probably end of April, facility maintenance, as part of their budget, will remove all of the asbestos. That leaves the building in a flexible position. As part of the CIP, you will be asked to consider not only the booklet that was received, but we did receive a proposal in today to add to the CIP. I don't know whether we can fund it, but we are looking at Old Station 2 to become a recreation satellite.
That brings up a thought about another building, the old EMS building back behind Belfort Homes. What's our thoughts with that? That's been sitting there a couple of years, I believe.
Well, what we did was, in the building that we first took possession of, that was on city property, we have now gone in and completely gutted that building, because when the rescue squad left, they left behind a lot of treasures. So we have now gotten rid of all the mold. The building is back down to basically the metal components and the insulation with the concrete floor. We will have to decide what we want to do with that building. There's an adjacent building that came through us through a tax sale, and Mr. Carter and I reviewed that building, I believe, Thursday or Friday of this past week. Yes. The same thing needs to happen with that. When they walked away from that building, they left behind, again, a lot of treasures. So over the next several weeks, we're going to be bringing in some part-time temporary employees through the agencies to help us completely clean out that building. Then we'll have to decide what do we want to do with those facilities in the long term. The problem with any of those buildings is they're not in the condition that anyone can simply walk in and start using. I mean, for Fire Station 2, to convert it, not only are you going to spend $25,000 to $30,000 to get rid of the asbestos, you're going to spend another, pick a number, at least $40,000 to $50,000 converting it so restrooms are handicapped accessible to meet the new codes. You're going to spend another, pick a number, $40,000 to $50,000 on any type of parking and improvements that you're going to need there, because in converting, you have to bring it up to code.
Right,
and those same numbers would exist, if not larger, for the two metal buildings that are left over at Wooten Park. So we don't have all the answers yet, but we are working on them.
How big is that lot at Fire Station 2?
It's larger than a residential lot.
Yeah.
I wouldn't think it's much more than a little over, you know. Oh, I don't know how big it.
It's rather confined, as I recall.
It's only like a couple lots bigger. I mean, a couple lots size. I mean, it's probably only probably an acre or so.
Hey, we were restricted by that creek.
Creek, you got to.
That's
right.
Yeah, it's not much potential for expansion.
Other questions about anything? Could we have a minute or two to talk about general things? I hope you did have a chance to look at the email. Anthony did a very nice job in this room last Tuesday when we had the business and property owners in the four-block area here of New Bridge Street. Got very good input. Basically, what they have said is they appreciate, first of all, that council is interested in these four blocks. They all said, well, not all, two of them said, don't do anything. But the other 17 or 18 votes that we got in said, absolutely, the quicker the better. You will notice in the email I sent you a list of comments that were given. The plan that they favor the best is a central median, but they are not talking about a central median that would be continuous. So today we delivered letters up and down the street, and then for those who actually aren't on the street but own property, we put in the mail an update letter that told them the results of the last meeting and the voting. We also showed them the comments. In probably 3 weeks, we're going to be back with that same group to further refine what a median in the middle of the street actually means. Some of the concepts that I thought were quite creative, instead of having a continuous median, what you could have would be a small median and then an area for delivery trucks that would be striped off, and then another small median. So you would have places for delivery vehicles to pull in. Another concept that Anthony found was to actually put in these, what I'm going to call pocket medians, and in between put more angle parking in the middle of the street. So we're going to explore a number of concepts, and all of that will be brought back to you. But I will say to you, the response that we got was extremely supportive.
Okay.
Thank you. Anyone else? Chair.
No, sir.
Let's go ahead and adjourn.
Second.
Motion to adjourn.
All in favor?
Aye.